welcome to the celebration of life for our dear, precious brother, McIlvain. He was a child of Christ, a husband, a father. He was a grandfather, a servant of the Lord, a man who fiercely loved his family, a man full of affection and laughter, and one that did not meet a stranger, if you knew Mac. He had a welcoming spirit, a big smile on his face, and he is now with the Lord Jesus. And today we come to give the Creator, his God, praise and thankfulness for his life. As we laugh and as we mourn and as we remember the precious gift that Mac was. The Psalms say in 116:15, precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his saints. Mac was a professor of faith in Christ Jesus. And today, again, he is with his Savior. And so think of it this way. He is healed. He is no longer in a wheelchair. He is laughing. He is smiling. He is with his Lord and he is rejoicing. But we are here and we want to remember him. And we want to mourn and laugh and enjoy who Mac was. So let us pray together. Would you pray with me? Eternal God, our loving Heavenly Father, who loves us with an everlasting love and can turn the shadow of death into rejoicing, help us now as we wait upon you with reverent and believing hearts. In the moments before us now, help us to speak of eternal things. Help us to be comforted by the scriptures that you've given us. And may we hope in the glorious resurrection of Christ. It is through our Lord's name that we pray. Amen. Let me begin by reading a scripture from Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in paths for righteousness, for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. And I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Let us stand as we sing Blessed Assurance.
Amen.
Philippians chapter 4, verse 7, and the peace of God, which surpasseth all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Ashley now is going to come and share her heart before you and our Father.
Hi, everybody. Wonderful to have you here to help us honor and celebrate our dad, Mac McIlvain. I think it's really important to start off by acknowledging all the people who are in the room today and those that are not, that walked through life with our dad and that shared so much joy with our dad. His parents, Robert and Mildred, of course, and his beloved brother, Jim. His soulmate, Kimball, whom he shared 38 years of marriage and more adventures than we can count, as these pictures attest. And this is just the tip of the iceberg. It was so much fun putting them together and just remembering. Brother and sisters-in-law here today from all across the country, nieces and nephews, fellow Marines and other friends have come from across Texas and across the country here today from Alaska, Arizona, Tennessee, New Jersey, California, Florida. I'm sure I'm missing other places, but it's just such a testament to the deep bonds that he has forged with all of you and with people throughout his life. And so for Whitney and Lindsay and Clay and me and Sean and his grandchildren here today, he leaves a big hole in our hearts, of course, but he also leaves us with a lot of memories. Memories of our times together and also of how he lived with a full heart, which we will hold with us forever, because Dad's was a life very well lived. He always had a smile and a laugh on, as I have heard from every single one of you that I've spoken with, and as we know from spending time with him, as I've heard so many of you say, he lit up a room when he came in and he made you feel like family, whether you were or not. He loved talking with friends, old and new, connecting with family and just being there for people. He was always there to help, always, no matter the issue or the time of day. And given that he was a night owl, like every McIlvain before and every McIlvain since, it was completely fine if we needed to talk things through at midnight, maybe better, I don't know. And his spirit of adventure took him to many places through life, as you all can see and as you all know. Living in Texas, Illinois, Pennsylvania, Vietnam, California, New York, Alaska, back to his beloved Texas, of course, traveling with family to every corner of the U.S., from California to Florida to Hawaii to New York and North Carolina, New England, and many states in between on so many cross-country drives and travels abroad. He just loved the adventures that these new experiences brought. I always think of him, you know, flying helicopters and training new pilots in California, hiking glaciers, snowmobiling on back trails, watching the northern lights, watching midnight sunsets in Alaska, riding his motorcycle across country. But most of all, he loved having these adventures with family and friends. And he accomplished so much in his life. It's hard, very hard to encapsulate it in a few words in a few days of conversations, but he raised three happy, healthy children who adore him, provided a foundation for them to raise their own kids, and supported them all the way. He married his soulmate, Kimball, made him complete and happy, and with whom he shared just everything. He found great success in life and work, as many of you personally know, with a talent for computers and even more of a talent of sharing that skill and everything he had with anybody else who needed it. And he found a great pride and joy in serving his country as a medevac helicopter pilot for the U.S. Marine Corps in Vietnam with distinction, earning a Purple Heart when wounded in the line of duty, the Air Medal for acts of heroism while flying, and the Distinguished Flying Cross, which is the country's highest award for aerial achievement for exceptional achievement in heroism while flying. And as many of you know personally here, he ultimately flew 880 missions in Vietnam, and as we've also heard from so many of you who served with him, true to form, he was always ready with a smile to help keep up morale, and that's how we always think of him, smiling and buoying the mood and just really being that light in the room. So today we're here celebrating a great dad and a great human being. So our comfort is that he led a fulfilling life and left here a very happy person. Thanks to all of you in this room and others who couldn't be here. But our inspiration is that Dad left this earth much better than he found it. So Dad's physical presence may be gone, but his legacy will continue to live in our hearts and our minds. So Dad, we love you. You'll be greatly missed and always remembered. Thank you.
Please stand for the singing of Great Is Thy Faithfulness.
Psalm 34, verse 18. The Lord is near to the brokenhearted and saves the crushed in spirit. Now, Mac's daughter Lindsay's going to come and share her heart for her father.
Growing up, I was notorious for stealing Daddy's food. We'd be having a meal, and any time I'd finish my meal and still be hungry, I'd glance over at Daddy's plate to see what he had left. Mom and Whitney always knew when it was coming because they'd see my eyes scan his plate. My eyes would catch his last piece of bacon, and I'd ask, "Daddy, are you going to eat that?" Already knowing that he was indeed planning to eat the last piece, because he would never leave just one lonely piece of bacon on his plate. Without hesitation, he'd smile and say, "No, Luffy, would you like my last piece?" Whitney and Mama would chime in, "Lindsay, don't take Daddy's food." I'd reply with, "But he said I could have it." Generous. Whether it was his time, his knowledge, his resources, his advice, his comfort, his safety, and yes, even his last piece of bacon, he offered each generously to all he encountered, never asking for anything in return. Caring. Daddy cared deeply about everything we did. He somehow always made the ordinary feel extraordinary. Whether it was a shopping trip, or getting our hair cut, or getting our nails done, Daddy never missed a moment to reassure us that everything we did mattered to him. Supportive. Everything we did growing up, we knew we had his unwavering support. From the sidelines of soccer games, ringside at horse shows, and bleachers at basketball games, he was always there with a smile and never shy in letting people know, "Those are my daughters." Even when we couldn't see him, we always knew he was there. Our number one fan was always cheering us on, and he made a big deal out of everything we did. Dependable. Some in this room today depended on Daddy to be the best pilot he could be, just as much as he depended on them during their time serving in Vietnam. They always had each other's backs. Some here today depended on him to be a friend and to be their prayer warrior during times of difficulty. Daddy could make you laugh, console you, and always offer the best bear hugs. Our mama depended on him as her husband to help lead their family and to instill a strong moral compass and even stronger biblical convictions in each of their children, herself included. Thank you, Mama, for never leaving Daddy's side. Three people here today depended on him to take care of their sister and to protect her and cherish her with all his heart. That which he did lovingly every day for their entire 38 years of marriage. Six sweet little ones here today depended on him as the best granddaddy he could possibly be. They knew his love for them ran deep. And while they could always depend on him, likewise, he knew he could always depend on them to help sneak him extra dessert whenever their grand wasn't looking. Two men here today depended on Daddy without realizing it and before they even knew him, as he was busy raising his daughters who would one day become their wives and the mothers of each of their children. And three of us here today depended on him as our daddy. To have been raised, known, cherished, and completely adored by him was the gift of a lifetime. He proudly wore girl dad as a badge of honor. The Lord graciously equipped Daddy to raise three daughters with the same tenderness, grit, determination, care, and love for people that he himself had. He revered being our daddy, and more than that, we revered being his daughters. Here's a few tidbits from Daddy. Always drive with your lights on, even in broad daylight. If you always tell the truth, you never have to remember what you said. If you had to ask him to check your tires to see if you needed new ones, the answer was always yes. Manners matter. Go big or go home. Life's short, eat dessert first. If one is good, 10 is better. It's only acceptable to listen to Toby Keith's Courtesy of the Red, White, and Blue on full volume. And your wintertime in Alaska, driving with the sunroof open and heat on high is the acceptable way to drive around town. And even when you feel full, always remember that there's a separate dessert pouch that can still be filled. Even on our hardest days, Daddy's headship over our family offered us unconditional safety and reassurance that everything was going to be okay. He is no longer here to offer us that safety, but he left behind the reassurance that we will always be held by Jesus, and we will always find shelter beneath the shadow of his wings. Dearest Daddy, we love you with all our hearts. And we will spend every remaining day of our lives continuing your legacy, upholding the morals you instilled in us, loving people in the same manner you loved, and telling others about Jesus just as you did. Semper Fi, Daddy. Ride like the wind.
Thank you.
And as you think about Mac, there are so many stories, so much laughter and joy, obviously so much love and care for his family. He was a dear brother. And my memories of him were of, one time we had our car break down, and for those of you who know me, we still have a lot of kids, but we had a lot of kids at that time, and we needed something to haul our kids around. And it was known that it was going to be a while before the car was ready, and so Matt came up to me at church. He says, "Look, I have a car. If you need it, you can borrow it for as long as you want." That was Matt's generosity. Other times I would be sitting around with my phone on a Sunday afternoon, I would hear a ding and I would look down, Max sent me a joke. Lots of times I knew if I open this, I'm really going to laugh or I'm going to go, "I cannot believe you sent that to me, Max." He had such a great sense of humor. Just know, even as I would come down, he was very much like me. I'm a toucher. It's kind of weird. And that's the way Mac was, is if you came up to him, he would pat you on the shoulder. He would want to stick out his hand. He would want to hug you. That was Mac. He was a loving and generous and kind and funny man. And when we think about life in that way, that one person can have such a touch to everyone around you, it's quite amazing, isn't it? It's quite amazing. At the same time, we hold these thoughts in our minds that Mac is gone from this earth at this time, and we won't see him until the Lord returns, but we will see him. And so today, as we think about that, I wanted to share some comfort for the family. And so I wanted to talk about a passage from John chapter 11. From John chapter 11, and Jesus knew death intimately. And he brings us a lot of hope in this passage. To kind of give you an idea of what's going on here, the disciples were on the other side of the Jordan River, and they were hanging out probably in the area where John the Baptist was baptizing people years before. And a messenger came as the disciples were gathered there from Bethany, and he had a look of great concern on his face as he brought that message. And the message was from Jesus' dear friends, Mary and Martha. Lazarus, their brother, was sick. He was gravely ill. So expected to die. So Jesus said something very wild. "Well, let's stay here for a while." And he waited some 3 days. And on the fourth day, we read this from John chapter 11. "And when Jesus came, he found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb 4 days. Bethany was near Jerusalem, about 2 miles off, and many of the Jews had come to Martha and to Mary to console them concerning their brother. So when Martha heard that Jesus was coming, he went and he met him. But Mary remained seated house. Martha said to Jesus, 'Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But even now I know that whatever you ask from God, God will give you.' Jesus said to her, 'Your brother will rise again.' Martha said to him, 'I know he will rise again in the resurrection on the last day.' Jesus said to her, 'I am a resurrection and life. Whoever believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live. And everyone who lives and believes in me shall never die. Do you believe this?' She said to him, 'Yes, Lord. I believe that you are the Christ, the Son of God, who is coming into the world.' You pray with me. Oh, Lord God, grant us your Holy Spirit in these moments and in these words of your scriptures, that our hearts might be lifted up, that they may be encouraged and comforted. Set our minds on heavenly realities. We pray this in Christ's name. Amen. the first thing we see here with this particular event and with this family is a problem. And it is a problem that we all have. These two sisters deeply loved their brother. They cared for him. And he was a friend of Jesus. And they were held by the same paralyzing fear that has frozen so many hearts throughout time as they watched their loved one being grasped by death. And we all know how powerless it is to do anything about it. Death is power. It's powerful, it's ominous, it's merciless. It's an adversary that grasps for all that is living in the world. But why? That is the question, why? Why is it that way? Why do we all have to die? God has answered this question for us, and it is not a pleasant answer. But it is the truth. It's the truth. The scripture takes a mirror and it reflects the shocking reality of our own story that we have all sinned against the Lord and have rejected our Creator. All you have to do is to turn on the evening news or pick up a newspaper to see this. Our rebellion against God has resulted in misery, in murder, in war, in stealing, in deception, in pain, and suffering, and persecution, and injustice. It's what we would call, or philosophers would call, man's inhumanity to man. We can even see this close up in our own families, in our own lives. Something hurtful is said, and days and weeks and months and even years go by, and later, it still hurts. It creates division in relationships. We all know this to be true. This world is filled with brokenness. You see, we have a rebellious, self-sufficient, I am a little God sort of heart, and I will do what I want to do. And I don't care what anyone else says. That's the attitude that we have also toward our Creator God. And this is what the Scriptures call sin. Because of this sin, God handed down a sentence upon mankind, a judgment, if you will. And this world was cursed with turmoil and death. And all will eventually face judgment, the final judgment. For the scripture tells us that God is holy, and he is just, and he is righteous. Paul puts it this way, for just as sin entered the world through one man, and death through sin, and in this way death came to all people because all sinned. Death comes to us all. And that is a reality that we have to face, and we have to think about. We're thinking about it today especially. But, thankfully, God not only has revealed this to us, that we have a problem, but he has also revealed to us that he deeply cares, that he deeply loves us. And we can see it in this passage. I just read a certain part, but if you continue reading in John 11, you will see in verse 33, when Jesus saw Mary weeping and the Jews who had come with her also weeping, he was deeply moved in his spirit and he was greatly troubled. Now the word here for deeply moved in the original is stronger, and it's a closer idea to this, to the thought of being outraged in spirit. Jesus was moved. He was outraged at death. He was indignant. He was angry. So Jesus' reaction to the presence of death and the line of sin in this world is an outrage for this ugly intruder. We are not meant to die. We are meant to live forever. And we realize that in our hearts. So Jesus was angry. There is another reaction that we see here as well. We see sympathy. Sympathy. In verse 35, we read the words, Jesus wept. So not only was he moved and outraged against death, but he wept. Think about that. He wept for his dear friend. This should spark a flicker of hope within our hearts. A hope of great comfort. Why? Because the text also points to us this idea of a solution. There's a solution to this death. And even though Jesus is angry, and even though Jesus weeps, he knows the solution. He's already spoken of it. Though God is a holy God and a just God, he is a loving God and full of grace. And in verse 23, Jesus said to Martha, once again, your brother will rise again. And she says, I know he'll rise again in the last day. But Jesus goes deeper. And he says, I am the resurrection and the life. I am the resurrection and the life. And if you believe in me, you too will live. Those are amazing words. And so what does he mean? One author puts it this way. It's as if Jesus were saying, Martha, the pain is too great. The suffering too real. It's too universal. It's too comprehensive. It's not just that I come to do something, Martha. I want you to look me in the eyes, and I want you to see that I am something. I have not come to be a heavenly, touching, healing agent. I have not come just to merely perform miracles. I have come in my person as the resurrection and life. I am not merely here to create miracles and to take away infirmities. I am here to direct a whole system. Jesus is the resurrection and the life. It is his identity. As John says earlier in the book, all things, think of these words, all things were made through him. In him was life. In other words, nothing else is in fact life outside of Jesus. He is the spark. He brings animation. He is the existence. He is the one who spoke all things into life, and he breathed life into mankind. And with him comes the hope of resurrection. He then can say with complete authority, whoever believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live. Everyone who believes in me shall never die. When Jesus himself is present, so is life. And therefore, so is resurrection power of life. There is a story of a man who was once conversing with a Brahmin priest, and he asked the question, could you say I am the resurrection and the life? And the priest said, yes, I can say that. To which the man responded, but could you make anyone believe that? His answer, no, I could not. But understand, historically speaking, in reality, in time and space, Jesus did just that. As we continue in the unfolding of this event in verse 39, Jesus instructed them to remove the stone from the tomb there where Lazarus was buried. And they did, and Jesus raised his eyes into heaven, and he said, Father, I am grateful that you have listened to me. I know you always listen, but on account of this crowd standing here, I've spoken so that they may believe that you sent me. Then he said these words, Lazarus, come forth. I'm convinced if he had not just called out Lazarus' name, that the whole community of dead would have walked out of the tombs. And he came out, and he was wrapped from head to toe with a cloth over his face, and he was teeming with new life. And Jesus displayed to all those present that he is, in fact, the resurrection and the life. Now, you would think, at that sort of event, at that sort of happening, that this would bring rejoicing and that eyes would see this incredible miracle of Jesus and turn to him. Well, some did. As a matter of fact, a bunch did. And that bothered the religious officials so much that they began to plot against him and to set a time for his timely death. They drummed up false charges against him. They had him arrested, had him beat, and they had him placed upon a cross where he died as a criminal beside two thieves. However, who is the resurrection and the life? It's Jesus. And Jesus rose from the dead in resurrection power. And the scriptures, which are a witness to us, they're a witness to us, says that he appeared to over 500 of his disciples. And he ascended into heaven where he sits right now at this moment at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. And he intercedes for us and he's waiting to return. He's waiting to return to call all out of the grave. He will say, come forth. At that time, all the graves shall empty. Judgment shall be rendered and all things will be made right by the holy and just God. John puts it this way in the book of Revelation. God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There shall be no more death, nor sorrow, nor crying. There shall be no more pain, for the former things have passed away. Then he who sat on the throne said, and this is Jesus, behold, I make all things new. So Jesus' simple question to Martha and to us here today is, do you believe this? Do you believe this? Do you believe that he is the resurrection and the life? Do you believe that he rose from the dead and is alive today? Will you grasp on to the hope in your loss and your sorrow? Will you understand that Mac is way, way better off than he's ever been? It's like that children's story that C.S. Lewis wrote called The Chronicles of Narnia. And the children have to come back to this world. And there's a movie about this. And when we were watching it as a family, I told my children, I don't ever want to go back. I want to stay. I want to be in the presence of the Lord. And that's where he is. He is completely healed. He is sinless. And he has that big smile on his face. And he's dancing a jig. And he's laughing, and he's waiting to rejoice with those who will join him who are in Christ Jesus. Well, those of you here today, hear these words of love from Christ. The truth is that he is weeping with compassion of love. He loves you so much that he gave himself for you, that you would have hope of resurrection. If you have never believed in Christ, will you hear and believe today? He loves you so deeply that he came to take the penalty of your sin upon himself, that you might receive his righteousness. So you see, dear friends, as we step into this text briefly this morning, Jesus looks at us with a twinkle in his eye, and he says, I am the resurrection and the life. Believe it, and you will live. This is comforting. This is hope in the pain of loss. Kimball, children, grandchildren, family and friends, Christ is the Lord, and he is your comfort. He is your hope. God is with those who mourn and who weep, for he understands. Paul says, O death, where is your victory? O Christ, O death, where is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is law, but thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. For death is swallowed up in victory. Will you take that hope this morning and know that it's true? Let's pray together. Father, we thank you for your love and mercy. We ask you, please, drive this hope down deep into our lives that we would believe it and hold on to, and we would know that it's true. Be with us as we mourn. Be with us as we weep. Be with us as we remember. In all this, Lord, be glorified. We thank you for the life that you gave us. A brother, husband, father, a grandfather, and a loving friend. We praise you in Christ's name. Would you stand as we sing Holy, Holy, Holy? Salina. You can look it up, I think, online as well. But if you want to follow the procession, the family welcomes you to come for that. There will be a military funeral. Would you pray with me? Lord Jesus, you have conquered death, and for those who trust in you, its sting has been removed forever. Thank you that it is no longer to be dreaded or feared, but that it has become a gateway into your presence, Father. Thank you that death is not a full stop, but only a comma. We thank you for every special memory of our loved one, Mac, and for all the love that we shared during the years we enjoyed together. We thank you that all his trials and weaknesses and sorrows of this earth have ended. May we have the grace to say, the Lord gave, the Lord has taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. As Kimball and this family and all here face the future, may we also know the consolation of your presence and the assurance that for all who love the Savior, the promise is that one day we too will stand in your presence and be reunited with those who have gone before us in that same love and union with Christ. So may your comfort and strength keep us. We pray these things in the name of Jesus, who died and who rose again, that we may have eternal life. Amen.
Amen.
Lift up your faces and your hands and receive the benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. And the Lord lift his countenance upon you and give you peace, both now and forevermore. Amen.
magazine of blank ammunition. Load. Ready. Aim. Fire. Ready. Aim. Fire. Ready. Aim. Fire. Freeze it. On.
Please accept this one as a sign of appreciation. You know,
there's nothing more moving. I want to thank those men who just served and bless this family, and for all those who have served our country. Mac was a hero. He was a hero not only in serving this nation, but in serving his family and his community. What a blessing. As we come now to this time, I want to read from Revelation chapter 21, just six verses. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, "Behold, the dwelling place of God is with men. He will dwell with them, and they will be his people, and God himself will be their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and death shall be no more. Neither shall there be mourning, nor crying, nor pain any more, for the former things have passed away." And he who was seated on the throne said, "Behold, I am making all things new." And he also said, "Write this down, for these words are trustworthy, and they are true." And he said to me, "It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty I will give from the spring of the water of life without payment. For as much as it has pleased the Lord Almighty to take out of this world the soul of our dear brother and friend, McIlvain, we therefore commit this body to the ground, earth to earth, ashes to ashes, dust to dust. And we are looking for that blessed hope for when the Lord Jesus himself shall descend from heaven with a shout and with the voice of the archangel and with the trumpet of God, and the death and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be called up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so shall we ever be with the Lord. Therefore, let these words comfort you and give you peace." Kimball, you have been heroic too. You have stood beside Mac, and you have given so much love and so much care. We honor you as well, dear sister, for your love and your compassion. You are with us to the end. All of you, your family here, God is gracious, and he is loving, and he is kind, and he will be with you and keep you. May you be blessed, and may the Lord give you his peace. Let us pray together. Father, thank you so much for this time to honor and to lift up to stand in remembrance of our dear brother Mac. May you continue to comfort this family with your peace and your love, and may your grace overflow abundantly. Lord, again, we give you thanks for the gracious mercy and grace that you have shown us, the great love that you have shown us by giving us this man, but the greater love that you have shown us in giving your son. Lord, we look forward to seeing him again. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
better place I've heard a thousand times. And at least a thousand times I've rejoiced for you. But the reason why I'm broken, the reason why I cry, is how long must I wait to be with you? I close my eyes and I see your face. If home's where my heart is, then I'm out of place. Lord, won't you give me strength to make it through somehow? I've never been more homesick than now. Help me, Lord, 'cause I don't understand your ways. The reason why I wonder if I'll ever know. But even if you showed me, the hurt would be the same. 'Cause I'm still here, so far away from home. I close my eyes and I see your face. If a home's where my heart is, then I'm out of place. Lord, won't you give me strength to make it through somehow? I've never been more homesick than now. In Christ, there are no goodbyes. And in Christ, there is no end. So I'll hold on to Jesus with all that I have to see you.
All this world, just give me Jesus.
When I come to die, oh, when I come to die, give me Jesus, give me Jesus, give me Jesus. You can have all this world, just give me Jesus.
I've come to know, though my heart and flesh may fail, there's an anchor for my soul. I can say it is well. Jesus has overcome, and the grave is overwhelmed. The victory is won. He is risen from the dead, and I will rise when He calls my name. No more sorrow, no more pain. I will darkness breaks to light, and the shadows disappear, and my faith shall be my eyes. Jesus has overcome, and the grave is overwhelmed. Victory is won. He is risen from the dead, and I will rise when He calls my name. No more sorrow, no more pain. I will rise on eagle's wings before my God, fall on my knees and rise.
only imagine what it will be like when I walk by your side. I can only imagine what my eyes will see when your face is before me. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. I can only imagine. I can only imagine when that day comes and I find myself standing in the sun. I can only imagine when all I would do is forever, forever worship you. I can only imagine, yeah. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. Yeah, I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in all of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing and hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. Yeah, I can only imagine. I can only imagine. Yeah, I can only imagine when all I would do is forever, forever worship you. I can only imagine.
Thank you. was a secret chord that David played, and it pleased the Lord. But you don't really care for music, do you? Well, it goes like this: the fourth, the fifth, the minor fall, the major lift, the baffled king composing hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. La fede mia mi abbandonò, si perse ma si ritrovò, perché smarrito sempre la cercai. Bellezza, incanto e nostalgia ferirono la mente mia, che in lacrime santo nome tuo dirò, un nome che ormai non ho paura che risuoni dentro me. Di luce esplode la poesia come una sacra sinfonia che intona per il mondo. It wasn't much I couldn't feel, so I tried to touch. I've told the truth, I didn't come to fool you. And even though it all went wrong, I'll stand before the Lord of Song with nothing on my tongue.